That which does not kill me can only make me stronger. For real. I don't see why everybody feels as though they gotta tell me how to live my life. You know? Let me live, man.
Yeah, that will never not sound like chicken fried.
Dog, it's all your fault that we think it's chicken now.
Yeah, it just, it's stuck. You can't unhear it once you hear it. What's up, y'all? I want to thank everybody for joining us for episode 4 of Hoecially Awkward. Sincerely appreciate the support, whether you're a regular listener, share the link, word of mouth, whatever you're doing, thank you. If this is your first time joining us, I'd like to properly introduce myself. I am your host, Mimi, or Mimi Some 100, joined once again by my Tonedefradio fam.
What up?
Tone and Juan from the Def Fresh Show. If you don't know, I am the habitual line stepper, voice of the voiceless, and supreme in all things unladylike. So, for my weekly disclaimer, if women using obscene sexual language offend you in any way, this is where you get off this ride. Thanks for listening, and please be blessed.
Stand clear of the closing doors, please.
Goodbye.
That's petty.
Isn't that?
It's funny, though. It's still funny, though.
Man, I got a fucking mosquito bite on my back, and it's driving me nuts.
Is it in one of those hard-to-reach spots?
Yes, that's why I'm twitching that? And shit. I'm trying to get my damn intro out, and I feel like something is... it's bugging me. So, for those of you who are listening to this on drop day, my birthday's tomorrow. I will be spending my birthday, like that entire day, collecting birthday freebies. That's my goal. Especially because, like, I don't have a job now. Like, and it used to be hard because I would be at work, not getting off until almost 5. So, I'm trying to pick and choose where to go. Nigga, I got all day.
All day.
All day long. So if anybody is interested in hanging with me and buying your food so I can get my food free, don't hesitate to hit me up. You know, I would really enjoy your company and a free meal.
I don't think you will enjoy anybody's company, but you definitely going to get the free meal.
I shake my head at you.
Why?
Because.
I mean, BD's, they sent me mine. See, they used to do it before where they would send you a coupon for your birthday for, you know, a free unlimited bowl. And I was clutch. And then, you know, I got excited thinking that I was going to get that shit. And I opened my birthday email the year after. And it was like, you know, enjoy this buy one, get one. I was like, what the fuck is this? And then it ain't even unlimited bowl. It's like a buy one, get one, just a regular bowl.
They got smart. They sick of y'all nigga shit.
Man, I don't know. I don't like that shit. I feel cheated. Like, it's my birthday, fam. How y'all go get cheap on me on my birthday?
Now, is the coupon only good on your birthday, or can it...
No. It's for a specific, like, it, I think it's probably, like, maybe
14 days?
Days or something. Yeah. I think Radizio's is 14 days.
Maybe before you take that trip to Mexico, we'll have one last meal with you. Because for all we know, you might meet a Julio down there and change your mind and not come back.
Man, I'm going to be down there. I wonder if I can pass. It's like, pass it off as like Spanish if I go down there and like, underlay, EI. Like, if they had let that shit go.
Wait, what?
You know what? I think this is where I get off.
That's not Spanish. That's St. Louisism. Is that a word? St. Louisism?
I'm just saying, maybe with enough tequila, they won't notice.
St. Louis.
St. Louisian. Louisian.
Well, underlay is definitely a Spanish word.
I know, but yeah, I'm that's saying
like hurry it, like quickly, something like that. But then once you get to the EI, that you on your own.
Yeah, that's some shit Nelly made up.
That just probably sounds just racist to Mexicans.
That's that country shit. Is he used to riding fucking horses down there?
I'm just saying.
So. I don't feel like it would. I mean, I don't think they'd get offended though, right?
Who knows?
Well, if you don't come back because you said that shit, then you know they were offended.
If we get a phone call talking about, yeah, we have her. I'm not. I don't have a special set of skills. Right. To get you back.
Nick, you was in the Air Force.
My special set of skills consists of a computer. I'll hack my way into their computer to see where you are. But somebody gonna have to come get you. I'll take care of the girls.
Maybe we can get Anthony to
come. So basically, you niggas just gonna let me just sit in Mexico getting traded for fucking tamales and mules and shit, right? That's what we saying?
You a hardworking woman. You'll figure something out.
Wow.
Now you know me, Mimi.
Speechless.
I would be on the first plane to come get you. This nigga's not getting on the plane. So.
Oh, nigga, when I had an allergic reaction at the Super Bowl, he didn't even get up and come check on me, bro.
This is a true story.
In my defense.
You don't got no defense.
I was high as giraffe ass.
You had edibles that night, didn't you?
He did. That was he actually had, you had like 6 to 8, because I had 3.
When Tone came to get me from work, I was popping them motherfuckers in the liquor store.
He was.
Then I was popping them motherfuckers in Pick-A-Say when we go get the chicken. Then as we made it to Rabbi House, I was popping them motherfuckers before I gave you one. And then when they let me sit in that big comfortable ass chair, it was game over. I knew I wasn't going to move.
Fucking honestly, chunky. I didn't even know you had an allergic reaction until Ravi came back and said, because we heard the ambulance coming, but they kept saying it was for somebody else.
So well, it was.
It was, but then somehow it ended up being for you too.
I don't know if, do you eat so many edibles just because it's like it's something to eat, or do it just because you really be trying to get that high? Because with you being a big nigga and you going, like, popping so many edibles like that.
I think he just pop them to be popping them.
Well, they like candy.
Right.
So, you know how when you got, like, some Jolly Ranchers and you just eat them motherfuckers? Like, you don't eat them because you're trying to get high. You eat them because they taste good. And before you fucking know it, you high.
Right, because I had 3 and I was feeling fine until I got home.
Right.
And then that's when the paint started peeling off the wall.
It's just like people who smoke weed. Like, I feel like if we...
Oh, like when we were sitting here and watching Atlanta? Right. That day?
That day you were stuck in place?
First of all, I had a lot of shit on my mind.
Right. Like, how many...
We couldn't tell.
How many did we smoke that day?
We got up to about 5.
Right.
Because we had... You had 2, I had 2.
And I think
Western Chica had 1, yeah, for sure.
See, so she probably maxed out at like 1.5.
Right.
So 1.5, she was Gucci. It's niggas that I kick it with, they be like, all right, bro, you smoke 5. Like 5, that's even overdoing it for me. I feel like 3.5, I'm good. You can't get no higher.
No, I apologize. We did only have 3 because you took 1 home and I took 1 home. Because
niggas want to get fucking like airplane high. And then that's how you get the urge to want to smoke crack and shit.
What?
because niggas smoke continuously.
True. The weed don't have an effect, right, like it used to.
Because like if you smoke 5, when you smoke them 5, you're high as you're going to get. Just because you smoke 10, you're not going to get no higher because you're already high.
Right.
You have to let the high come down to go back up. But when niggas just continuously smoke, that's how you get the urge to smoke other shit because you chasing the high.
See, I only smoke just to calm my nerves. Once I'm chill, I'm done. I don't need to smoke no more.
Right, watch some TV.
I don't need to be so high that I'm too high where I can't do nothing because I'm paranoid.
When you can't function, it's not fun.
That's not fun. That's scary.
I just like to giggle.
Right. See, I'm with that. Smoke like 3 or 4. Let's watch TV. Because everything is fucking funny by then.
Well, it's like, okay, so we have different types of highs.
Right.
But that's how I feel because, you know, I'm not a smoker, I'm a drinker. And different liquor does different things.
Oh, for sure it does.
Yep. Oh, nigga, tequila.
Tequila brings out the hole in everybody.
Nigga.
Hennessy makes you make bad decisions. Victory vodka makes babies.
Yeah, like, you know, if I drink wine, I'm chilling and I'm, you know, I'm trying to get some sleep, trying to mellow out. If I drink vodka can kind of go either way depending on what I got on my mind and shit. Crown, I'm cool.
Yeah, Crown is your go-to.
Yeah, Crown, I drink that shit and I'm cool. Or even, you know, if I get some Remy, I don't fuck with Hennessy. It tastes like cardboard. I can't do it. No matter what I mix it with.
Hennessy is rough.
Hennessy tastes like
trash.
Rough.
Wet cardboard. Like, I would think, like, if you were to puree cardboard and put it in a glass. That's how Hennessy would taste.
And niggas be like, mix it with some apple juice. Like, no, bitch, you're not finna fuck up apple juice for me.
Man, see,
dog, that's a shitty situation.
Because my granny, we got the shit beat out us over her apple juice. But we were so drunk, we didn't feel it.
But that was Crown, though, wasn't it?
Yeah, it was Crown. Now, first of all, you got a house full of kids. Why are you putting this pitcher of apple juice with all this Crown in it?
Special apple juice?
Yeah, not telling. We kids, nigga. We playing, we get thirsty.
You do gotta label it a certain way. You can't just put the special drink in the fridge in the same pitcher you put the Kool-Aid in and don't expect the kids.
Nigga, we kids, we playing outside, we hot, we get thirsty, we come fucking this apple juice up. All of a sudden, nigga, I'm in the motherfucking middle of the hallway, laying on my back like a fucking turtle, stuck, giggling and shit. She came in, she saw that motherfucking picture was empty. Man, she beat everybody ass.
Well, it shouldn't have been too hard. Everybody was drunk, so wasn't nobody running nowhere.
Nigga, I would have been face first to a motherfucking wall that day. But yeah, tequila? Nigga.
I don't know. It do things to women that just... It'll make a Laurel give the draws to Steve Urkel.
But you know what? I think the thing with tequila that makes a bitch so nasty is like tequila make you compete with yourself and shit.
Y'all be trying to break y'all own high score?
Yeah.
I believe that.
Yeah, like tequila unlocks a special character, a cheat code of hope.
Achievement unlocked.
Exactly. And you sitting there like, damn. Then I was saying, bitch, that's all you got? Bitch, who you talking to? And you just arguing with yourself in your head, and then you telling yourself to go harder. It's tequila take you to a whole nother place, man. So if a nigga offer me tequila, I'm like, I don't trust him. I know what he trying to get from me. So don't come around offering me no Quavo, no 1800, no nothing, because I know what you want.
So what you're saying is for all the single men out there in the club, and if you ask a young lady what she drinking and it's any form of tequila, go ahead and shoot your shot, bruh.
Yeah, facts.
Yeah, if she's in the club drinking tequila, there is a very, very, very good chance that she gonna have some balls swiped right across her tongue that night. I mean, it might not be yours. You might not be that nigga. But somebody's just getting, she getting teabagged by somebody that night. Okay. I want to talk about extended friendships for a second. Because this is a thing that's been bugging me as far as like with social media. And we know for years, people have been on the whole no new friends thing. Like, I don't mind new friends. I'm not that type of person. I can get along with anybody. New friends are fine. Shady friends are not.
Fact.
And I can honestly say that I have a lovely extended family from social media, especially because it replaces most of the family that I have. I mean, I don't know how Juan made the cut, but he's still here. I love you, Juan. Bitch.
You've been trying to kill me since I was like 5.
It was before then. You just can't remember.
Damn, Shane.
I really hope you die first.
That is so rude.
I just want to do your eulogy.
But I like that in you. No, but third party friends. Like, you know those friends of friends that they not your friends? It's like y'all just hang with the same person or people that may put you together in the same places now and then. Like, y'all not mutual friends. It don't mean you don't like them or you beefing with them or none of that shit. You just really don't have a desire to make them motherfuckers your friend. You have people like you tolerate in doses and shit.
So basically you communicate with that person because they're tied to somebody you're already friends with.
Right. Okay. You know, like, you're not friend. You don't just hang out with them by yourself. You don't text them. You don't know. You only see this motherfucker when you around this person that y'all are mutual friends with.
Right.
Like, what do you feel the boundaries are in those type of situations?
Well, if this is not somebody who's kind of directly connected to my friend. So, like, my friend's baby mama or something like that. I definitely wouldn't be hanging out with them or nothing like that. So, the first thing is I wouldn't let them know where I live. So, if we having a kickback at the crib, and this is not somebody that I'm cool with, they can't come by the crib.
And I think that people look at it like you being petty.
I don't know you.
Right.
I don't know what you can do. When this party is over and I'm at work, you might be like, hey, I like that nigga TV. Let's go steal his shit.
Right, because you're not my friend.
Right.
And I don't feel that it's, you know, petty or immature. Like I said, y'all can be around each other and hang out and, you know, casually talk in the corner, you know, about a punch bowl or whatever the fuck you may do.
What?
I'm just saying. Most times when I'm there, it's because food there.
You got a point there. You got a point.
But I just feel like a lot of people overstep boundaries in sharing friends A, business with friend C. And I don't think that shit should fly.
Okay.
Like, your friend don't have nothing to do with me. That's not my friend. That's your friend. So, your friend that's not my friend should not know my personal business. That's your people.
Now, what if the question or the conversation being had is in correlation to something that's already been shared? So, let's say someone heard something about you, Mimi, but because they don't know you enough to come to you to ask, they go to the friend we have in common. It's like, hey, I heard, you know, that such and such was going on, and they said this about Mimi. Should that friend answer that question, or should they open up the door for that friend to come to you to ask you instead?
I guess I'm a question, like, what is the motive for even asking?
Okay, you're an open person, and everybody already knows about your situation. What if they didn't know you, but then they'd be like, oh, well, isn't Mimi the chick who has the situation going on with her? Because I heard someone talking about it before. Now, you publicly said everything about this regardless, but because you don't know this person that well, can the friend explain the situation?
Well, I mean, in that situation, because it's something that's already common knowledge.
Okay.
That's not a big deal. You're not, damn, man, you know, Mimi lost her job a month ago, and she been on Backpage selling pussy and shit trying to pay the bills. Like, even if that was the case.
Gotta pay that mortgage somehow.
Who the fuck is you to tell, like, that's me, even if I just sat down and said, damn, Tone, man, I never thought I'd say this, but, like, I've been having to resort to, you know, sell ass on Backpage. That ain't for you to go talk to your little wrestling buddies and shit about. Nigga, I told you.
Facts.
Them niggas ain't my friends.
No, they not.
I'm talking to you about my stresses and what's going on in my life.
Well, if you ever had the point where you had to resort to that, I will cut a small portion of my check to help you out. You don't need to put that dink and stuff on the market. We already see what it does to the people you willingly give it to.
Can we not talk about that? Like, just while saying. I'm in the same room, blood?
Look here. We have to deal with the aftermath of her cutting them off. So imagine if she was selling it.
Nah, niggas ain't finna be stalking me to the door like Myron did Diamond and shit.
Just saying.
Just let me in.
Like, if it got that rough, Mimi, I would just go ahead and give you money to go gamble down at Pato with and don't ask for none of it back, and we'll never speak of this conversation again. No, but I hear what you're saying. But what do you do about that one friend that shares freely? Like, they want everybody to be so cool that the things that the new friend feels is rubbing them the wrong way about you, they tell stuff to try to, what they think is easing the situation, but more so they're basically spilling the tea instead.
Some people just can't fucking help it.
Okay.
And I think in those cases, it's kind of, they are who they are and they don't even realize that they're doing that. So even though it's very fucking annoying, you can't really, I can't really be mad because they don't really, they don't get it.
Right.
Versus someone who's doing it just to spill the tea and be intentionally messy and,
okay,
oh, guess what I know about such and such now. Like, you know, this happened and that happened and that happened. Some people just can't stop talking. So before they know it, they fucking telling business because all they know how to, that's just, that's what they are, a big mouth. And that's one of the things I've talked about before. It was a Snapchat rant a long time ago that I did. There are some friends who will get upset with you because you don't tell them certain things about you. And they'll feel that, oh, well, you didn't tell me this was going on, so we must not really be that cool. No, I can trust you with my life and not trust you with a secret. I can feel that if you saw me sitting in a burning car, you would risk your life to save mine. But knowing you and your character and that you just can't help talking about everything that falls into your lap, I can still feel that I know better than to tell you my business. It don't mean that I don't like you. It don't mean that I don't consider you a friend. It don't mean that, you know what I'm saying, I won't ride for you. It just means that certain things I know not to disclose to you because you can't help it. You being a big mouth friend doesn't necessarily make you
a bad friend.
A bad friend. It's all in your intention.
Right.
So I've had that instance before. Like, you know, don't feel like if I decide not to tell you something, that is because I don't fuck with you. No, that's not the case. It's just something that, for whatever reason, and it's typically not even my reason because we all know I don't really give a fuck. I've talked about, you know, everything you can basically talk about.
Right.
Other things that other motherfuckers would go and bury themselves for, I've been able to be open about. So typically, if I'm not telling you something, it's because I'm protecting somebody else or something that they're dealing with and not myself. But yeah, I don't care for that shit at all, to just feel like it's okay to freely disclose your problems to your friends' problems to your other friends that you know they don't even really fuck with.
I ain't gonna say I don't like everybody, but everybody, like she just said, ain't really your friend. Like, right. If somebody invites me somewhere personally and, you know, we happen to go, we're there for that person,
right,
who invited us.
That's us, period. Right. Though.
I don't really know. Like, I ain't gonna say I don't know them because, you know, we all friends on social media. But, like, I've noticed that, like, when we're around other people, like, I can have a whole conversation with you via social media. But when I see you in person, it's a what up. And we keep that shit pushing.
All
right.
Like, because you haven't built something to have a conversation with.
Right. Like,
that's me. Hoecially awkward.
You are so awkward. We all are, honestly.
And people don't believe me when I tell them that.
Because they, you're so expressive online.
Right. So, but that's because I don't have you staring in my fucking face and making me feel all weird and shit. But I've always been like that. Yeah. I'm more expressive in writing. Nigga, I can type 3 pages in 5 minutes.
Right.
Worth of thoughts. But sitting in front of you, I'm like,
see, I'm more of a social loner. I will go to the events, but I'll be perfectly fine just chilling by myself or whatever couple of people that I'm there with and just enjoying the experience. Like, I don't have to be in the mix and mingle with everybody or talk to every single person I know. So even though I might see you at the party and I'd be like, what's up? And that's it. I'm not going to hold a 5-minute conversation about how's your life been since the last time I seen you, because when we walk out of here, I probably won't care.
Fact.
So yeah. I'm not going to waste your time.
See, I get those questions like when I do go out, because when motherfuckers are all together, I'm usually the only one fucking missing.
True.
So when they do see me there, it's like, well, damn, why, where you been? I'm like, you know, I'll be chilling because this environment that y'all like to be in, it ain't my kind of environment because, for one, I ain't no heavy drinker like that.
Right.
Which is why I'm usually somewhere in the corner on my phone because I'm high. Because I like to be high. I don't like to drink.
Plus, I didn't hit daddy duty status, and I actually like that shit. So I'll be staying home with the girls just because.
Then it's like I also feel like maybe, even though it ain't said, I feel like the vibe I get is the same vibe everybody else have. Like, I don't really fuck with you. So I'm not talking to you. And maybe motherfuckers be like, man, like, I don't really fuck with Juan, so why would I talk to Juan? And that's perfectly fine. That's a mutual understanding and silence. They won't fuck with each other. So ain't none of that fake shit. You ain't got to walk over. You ain't got to say nothing to me. We Gucci.
Because, I mean, it's people that I truly don't fuck with. And I'm able to be in the same space. Just, you don't say nothing to me. I don't say nothing to you. Being an adult, I don't have to be confrontational with you when I see you,
right,
just because I don't fuck with you on that level. It's not that serious. I don't have to fucking roll my eyes and smack my lips and this punk ass bitch whenever I see you. I don't gotta be on that. You stay in your lane. I stay in my lane. Ain't no crashes. We all go home in one piece.
Okay.
It's simple.
Now, I got a question. What about those situations where the new friend wants to get to know you better, but they tell the mutual friend in this scenario the reason why they didn't want to approach you because you always look mean or you have restless bitch face?
Do I? I don't think I do.
Sometimes you do.
I mainly be on my phone. I don't even give people eye contact.
Especially when you, and that could be what it is. Like, you be in your phone. It's like, cause let's be honest. Everybody knows who Mimi is.
I be in my phone to avoid talking to people.
And that's what I was getting ready to get to. Everybody knows who Mimi So 100 is. So when they see her out in public, they want to come meet the personality that's on their timeline. But they can't approach you because you're in your phone. And if you're not talking to somebody that...
I never had a problem, though.
You cool with.
I never had a problem. I'm out and I hear, is that Mimi? Hey, Mimi! Just when I was dropping the girls off to school. What's today?
Thursday?
Yeah, so when I took the girls to school on Tuesday, when I was walking in, it was, Mimi, hey, I'm your Facebook friend. Blah, blah, blah. I gave her a hug, held her baby, and played with her for a little bit. I'm very approachable.
Okay, maybe that's you. Maybe because everybody can't help but to want to talk to Mimi. But those are some of the situations, too, where you do have this social media person who you do know. But like Juan said, you're social media friends with them. You see them out in public. They just won't approach you because you look unapproachable.
Well, you know what? Speaking of, like, with me on social media and being approachable and all this other kind of stuff, like, I had a conversation with someone that I used to date. And he told me that my social media presence is intimidating.
I could see that from you.
But I don't know.
Like, as far as dating you?
Yeah.
Cause
he said, okay, he put it in three steps. I'm going to see if I can remember them all. I know it was...
broke you down in steps.
Okay, first...
we were five steps. Sorry.
You take them five steps out my door.
That was actually some pretty good harmonizing right there, though, bro. Well,
thank you.
So he said on the first point, you know, you see me and you like, damn, you know, she funny, she entertaining, you know. I like seeing her on my timeline, she keep me laughing, blah, 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 blah. But then it comes to a point where it's like, okay, it's kind of intimidating. Like, damn, man, she be going kind of hard on people. I don't know if I want to. You know, if I want to step to her, because, you know, when she go in, she go in.
When you scared, say you scared.
Shut up. You scared, go to church. And then it's that point where it's like, it's annoying, like, because when you deal with me, like, because I'm so open, I think that's one thing that I don't understand about dudes that approach me to date me. Y'all know how my personality is. Y'all know how open I am. Like, you know, no topic is off limits to me. If you know this before you approach me and you know that that's not the type of woman that you want, why do you bother? If you're like, well, I'm a private person and I'm, you know, I don't like attention or I don't this or I don't that. Like, I don't like outward attention. Like, if I'm out and just, like, in the middle of shit, I'm too awkward for that. I don't like people staring at me and all that weird shit. That's why when everybody be going out doing karaoke, I'm on my phone. I mean, I go for, you know, just to be around people and while they doing their thing, but I be in my own little zone. But I don't see how you can know that about me and still decide, hey, I want to fuck with her. You know, I want to date her. I want to be with her. But then when you with me, all you do is complain about all the shit that you knew about me before you got with me. What's the point?
Because niggas are weird.
Oh, I'm so glad that you admit
like, that. I was going to say, that's probably like the basic way to sum it up is.
Like, niggas are very weird. That's like when niggas get involved with, that's just like trying to date a stripper. Like, yeah, I'm comfortable with your lifestyle, but I get what you do.
Until shout you out to all the Lances in the world.
Right. Then 6 months later, you're like, hey, yo, babe, you know, I don't think it's cool that, you know.
When you gonna stop working at that dumbass club?
Right. Like,
oh, was it dumb when I met you there?
Nigga, it was, like, how is it dumb when she the one who keeping money in your pocket?
Right. Just, like, niggas are weird. Like,
she ain't eat that nigga no way. Y'all saw his lining.
If a nigga with a bad lining, you know what? I'm not even gonna finish that.
And her cousin was a hoe.
Shit, Ebony lining was better than his.
Oh my life, she's
taper. Okay, so moving on from friends, how do you feel about discussing your friend's business with your significant other? Do you feel that's acceptable? Because I mean, it's like there have to be limits somewhere. You don't want to come in, hey honey, how was your day? Oh, shit, it was cool. You know, we watched the game. Clown that nigga Rob because his girl burned him and shit. Like, dude.
Okay, I don't think it's... I think that's, like, situational.
Yeah, it's situational because you share stuff with your spouse or the person you dating about people anyway. Like, you might be telling the story. Like, girls will talk to their man about things going on with their girlfriends because they need an avenue to get that information out, especially knowing that the boyfriend is not going to run off and tell nobody. But you get some people that will go in depth about the whole situation.
Yeah,
so they'll tell the whole, they'll tell not only who the girlfriend is dating, but the dude she's sleeping with on the side, the night they went out to the club. Like, they'll tell the whole story so you get an understanding that, well, last night she was sleeping in her car because the boyfriend found out about the side nigga. So they tell you everything. But then you get some situations where it's like, yeah, you know, Mimi lost her job the other day. Hey, can you see if there's any openings at your job so I can go ahead and send her the information? So, like, it makes sense to say you lost your job to Teresa because
you would be trying.
I'm trying to help,
right?
But if I was just like, dog,
Mimi got fired. They
got fired. Let me tell you the fuck shit that happened, dog. Her job was on ABCD.
Right.
Being the fact it's Teresa and she knows who you is. Even then, in my opinion, that's still walking a thin line because it's not like she doesn't know who you is or your situation, but that might not have been something you want to share just yet.
And I think that's where people don't realize where personal is too personal.
Right.
Like, you know, if my nigga texts me, hey, what you doing? I'm not go, oh, hey, baby, sitting here with Tracy at the abortion clinic. Her ass didn't know who her baby daddy was, so she just finna get an abortion.
Damn.
That's funny though.
Damn.
Like, you have to know where the line, and I get it. You know, the whole, well, we in a relationship or in a marriage, and you know, it ain't no secrets between us. Ain't no secrets between y'all. That don't got shit to do with my business though.
True.
Sometimes secrets is cool. Sometimes. Because I don't, like, when you dating people, like, I don't ever want to be in that awkward situation. Because, like, I tell, like, chicks out there, like, we could be cool. Like, I'll date you. You know, we the shit right now. This is us. I don't want to meet your friends. Because I know.
Why not?
Because I know how women are. Now, I don't know how all women are. But, like, you going to go through shit with your friends. Right. And you going to come home or wherever we at. And you're going to bring that shit home. And you're going to tell me about your life and what happened. And I'm going to know all your friends' business. I don't ever want to be in that situation where it's like, all you bitches is in the same room and I know everything about everybody. And I'm just looking at you motherfuckers funny because I know that one's a hoe and she sucked dick right before she got here. So she probably shouldn't drink out that cup. She's burning. She shouldn't use the motherfucking toilet. I don't know what's going to happen. I just don't want to be that guy.
And I feel you. But then, but don't women want their man to be their best friend? Nope. So they share all the information anyway.
I learned my
lesson.
See,
I don't want a man that wants to sit there and listen to all the gossip about my friends. I don't want that kind of nigga in my life.
And I'm not saying that you don't, but there's women that do. So they want that guy who can listen. And then, of course, you be stuck here when your friend told, your girl told you that she ate her friend's pussy the other day. Now you sit at the dinner table with four bitches and you just looking at them like, y'all some nasty hoes. Like,
because I feel like when you know too much, then you get involved in shit that you don't really want to be involved
Facts.
In.
Yeah.
Like, there's no way that I should be out at 3 o'clock in the morning riding with you to go pick up this motherfucker because her boyfriend slapping her up. So then I feel like if you go in there and he in the middle of physically fucking abusing her and then he do something to you, I'm obligated to walk in and defend your honor because you are who I'm sticking my dick in.
But she brung you so you could step in and
That's what I'm saying. Like, this ain't for me. Like, just sitting in the car like, I could really be at home playing Xbox right now. Like, I shouldn't even be here.
Like, I gotta work in the morning. Her, but I'm trying to go home and slap your cheeks. Like, what's going on?
Right.
And now this just gonna mess up all the play you get because for the next month she gonna be living with us.
Yeah, that's.
I had a problem when I was locked up, and my cousin baby daddy reading my fucking letters and shit. So when I found that out, like, nigga, I got pissed. Like, fuck, it's bad enough the fucking COs is reading my shit before.
before I can even get them.
Right. Like, it's bad enough that I have to deal with these motherfuckers being in my shit. And now.
They had to proofread.
The grammar Nazis.
Man, real quick. So let me give y'all a quick story about roll call, like mail call, right?
Mail call.
So. They had these big ass buckets, like full of all the mail, and they would have the COs in there. And they'd call everybody in there, you know, yell your name, everybody pass your letters back and shit. And the crocodile hunter,
what?
He had just died and shit. You know, I was around, it was plenty of white motherfuckers in there and shit. I was in the feds. So I don't know what happened, but it was my birthday.
That's even worse.
Yeah, man, I asked for my birthday in there. But, dog, I got so much love. They sent me so many cards. I had cards and all kind of shit. So, when I realized, like, how much mail I had, this is one lady, she was over there sad as fuck because she ain't getting no letter. And she was like, I can't take this. She was like, first the crocodile hunter dies and now I don't have any mail. And before I knew it, I was like, crikey. Like, hey, she got mad as fuck. She was like, you show some goddamn respect. I look like the fuck. And y'all know I'm goofy. So I fucked with her from that point on. Like, I couldn't help it. I only did it for like 2 weeks. But I was like, dog, man, she got mad. I was like, damn, man. I hope like she don't shake me in my sleep and shit.
She loved the crocodile hunter. He was a real ass dude.
But it was like a reflex. Like, I wasn't even trying to do it. It just happened. Now I feel bad and shit. I wonder if she's still in there.
First, did you ever find out what she was in there to begin with for?
I'm going to tell you like this. Most of the white bitches was in there for meth, and you could tell by their teeth.
Yep.
Yep, almost every bitch in there was in there for meth. They weren't in there for no violent shit. They was fucking druggies. Then there was this one big bitch in there, Terry. She She looked like the Undertaker sister.
Is that the one that can make a lasagna in the microwave?
No. No, that one. Damn, I forgot her name.
Hey, bruh, when you been
behind... B is not finna discuss all my prison stories. I just want to put that out there.
I just want to know who makes the lasagna in the microwave.
We'll save that for a death fresh topic.
Definitely a death fresh, yeah.
Bottom line, the point is, your friend is your friend and only your friend, not my friend. Don't tell that bitch my business unless I give you permission to tell that bitch my business. Because I just might get both of y'all in some shit. So.
Damn.
And this was a public service announcement.
Okay, now we've all been through breakups, right? You've been
Sadly, yes.
You've been through breakups, Tom?
Yes, I have.
You've been through breakups, Juan?
No, it never happened to me.
See, during the late 90s, I had this little fake. Let's get
the late 90s, nigga. Damn, how old
are you? Nigga, y'all know I graduated high school in like 96. I was young, but still. And like, then there was the Air Force years. And
goddamn. Oh, it's fuck.
I just told y'all I'll be 40 soon, okay?
Wait, damn. 96, how old was you? You was 12. Well, that was WrestleMania 12.
And you 96, years. I was just in sixth grade.
Yeah. I was like 8.
Yeah, I was graduating.
You
high
was
school.
18.
No, I was like 17.
We're going on 18.
Yeah, going on 18.
Damn, you really
you
legit
was 17 10? Going on 50.
You know what? You not about the Morgan Freeman me.
You Morgan Freeman got your jeans.
Used to call you Crazy Joe, now they call you Batman.
To all you guys that are out there listening, if you can actually find a photo of a young Morgan Freeman, will you please post that in the Hoecially Awkward
in color
group? I don't think it would be in color. But
I don't want to see no black and white.
I think they didn't have Technicolor yet.
Yeah, because we've been trying to figure this shit out.
Yeah,
for
we were trying to find a photo because everything we keep finding this dude, he been old. So if you can find a young one, and not that makeshift classmate photo that they be making of themselves for them little yearbooks. No, we talking about an actual photo of this dude.
You get on my nerves. Okay, so.
Hey, we gotta plug the group.
While everybody has had breakups, it's fucked up because sometimes we breaking up with motherfuckers that we ain't in a relationship with in the first fucking place.
Man.
I think that's the weirdest shit.
That'd be the funniest that you never knew that you was involved with this person. Okay, so quick story time from Tom. We're gonna make this fast. When me and Teresa first started dating, we didn't start dating, we were just talking, you know. Being young adults, she had a friend who basically told this glorious story about this guy that she was so in love with and that this was the one and they were meant to be together in the whole nine yards.
You might know Miss Parker situation, was it?
Kind of.
Professor Ovi.
Kind of. But this is where it got funny to me. So while she was telling the story, her and Teresa was walking over to where I was working at the time. They come in there. She's like, oh, yeah, he works over here. They walk into my store, and I immediately talk to Teresa. I was like, hey, me and the guys are going to such and such. You want to roll with us tonight? Yeah, sure. And I was like, oh, hey. And to the girl, like, oh, hey, and just went back to work. Teresa never knew that the whole time the girl was talking about me. I've never went on a date with this girl. I never done nothing more than to ride the bus home with her because we lived in the same area and my stop was like 3 stops before her stop. But she made this whole elaborate story that we were in a full-blown 6-month relationship.
Maybe y'all were.
In her mind, yeah.
Hey, look, man, sometimes you gotta date a motherfucker and they just not know.
That's worse than you saying it's not rape if you yell surprise.
But that's not even what I meant like that person that you fuck with. Y'all do everything like y'all fucking fight like y'all in a relationship.
Ooh.
And everything, but you not in a relationship.
Does work wives and husbands count too? Because me,
do they fight?
I have.
I thought the work wives and husbands were usually like the release from it all. They just bring you food and like
it depends if you and one of
wife suck dick.
I mean, because I was actually one. Fucking a nigga from work before, so
that's different. You overstepped your role.
No, we were smooth. See, I'm cool on that shit.
I
well, y'all know I move like a nigga most times.
You do.
So it was easy for me. And I think it caught him off guard after that first day, because when we got to work, he probably thought I was going to be acting different.
Right, because most people do.
And you know that I was going to be all giggling. Like, I walked right past him and I went to my cubicle. Like, shit was, and then, next thing you know, every day he come into my cubicle and shit.
No, at my job, the work wives and husbands really do be fighting like real wives and husbands. So that's why I had to say that. But no, they really do.
Yeah, see, I thought that was just different. They just, you know, y'all flirt and talk y'all little shit and occasionally buy each other lunch and shit like that. I never knew it was like an actual.
No, it's done evolved.
Really?
Yeah, it's evolved.
Man, that sounds complicated. I wouldn't want that at work.
Well, the difference is when you're sick and tired of them, you go home to your real relationship.
Well, see, he walked up behind me because the way that my cubicle was, my back was facing outwards. Some people were lucky enough to where they were, you know, the opposite way.
Right.
So you can be doing whatever you want to do on your fucking computer and nobody can see it. All my shit was out in the open. So I'm looking down like this, scrolling my phone and shit. I'm looking at a dick that was sent to me. It's a nude. So he come up thinking that he finna whisper some shit in my ear. And he like, oh. And I looked, I said, ah. He's like, well, I see you busy. Like, don't creep on me, bro. You don't know what's going to happen. Especially you coming in all quiet and cat-like and shit. Intentionally creeping because you see me scrolling on my phone. And now look, you got some nigga dick image burned in your head all day. That's what you get.
You got dick on the brain.
Like, that's what the fuck you get. But I can't. That was basically like my current situation this week. Like, I was blocked by my bae. That's sort of bae, but not really my bae. Because he was being light skinned and shit.
So he was a dude training to be a dude, acting like another dude.
But like, when breakups aren't mutual, how do you determine, man, fuck them, versus, man, I gotta get them back? And like, if you do decide to get them back, how much effort or how long do you feel like you want to try? Like, when do you just say, okay, fuck it, I'm gonna throw in a towel? And when do you be like, man, fuck it, I'm finna break out that Carl Thomas linen and get emotional in this shit? Like, what is the determining factor for you to say, man, fuck them, versus, man, I ain't letting this shit go?
With me, it was always, was what this person bringing to the table greater than what was out there that I can get replaced? So if this girl had, like, motivation, own crib. Like, you remember I was young at the time. Motivation, own crib, car. Like, things that was beneficial to the overall standing of the relationship. Or I can date a chick who still wear Reeboks and on the bus. Which one was more beneficial for me at the time? So if it was like, okay, this girl got bored.
So you was using people?
I was young. I was in the Air Force. Of course I was using people.
At least she was honest about it.
I'm never denied that I wasn't using people. Like, I had got a reputation at one point in time. But, and they were still coming around. But then it turned into, like, did I really care about her? Because if it was one of those, well, you'll be gone in a couple of weeks to a new base, I'm not going to care. So if you want to end it, fine, fuck it. I would have moved on to somebody else. But it was like, the vibe was good, and I'm really feeling her. And like, dog, I really dig this chick. This chick gets me, I get her. Let me stop being a dumbass and try to make this work. And I would try to fix it.
What about you, Juan?
I feel like breakups go in stages. At least it will with me.
It definitely does go in stages.
If you catch me when I'm still in the vulnerable stage of being emotional, then we could probably work it out. But if you've let me get to the, okay, fuck it, I'm off this shit, then, there's no coming back to this.
You feel like that? I feel like you've been down this road.
I've been down this road a couple times.
How did you feel when you reached that point and you were like, man, fuck you?
Like, you just got to get there. Like, you can't force it. Because if you force the fuck you, then you become better. You just kind of got to let that shit gradually fade out. With me, you just got to let that shit gradually go.
You just smoke the pain away.
My first girlfriend got that. And listen to Prostitute for Lions by Lil
Wayne. He played that song so fucking much.
Which is why I tell people it's the greatest love song ever.
You know, it's so many people that didn't even know, and we're not finna make this a topic, but it's so many people that didn't know anything about Music Soul Child.
And they didn't know where he got the song from.
We'll save that for one of our new music show we're gonna create.
See, I'm an out of sight, out of mind chick. Like, as long as I'm not seeing you or talking to you, I'm cool. Like Juan said, like, go through my little stages. Like, you know, those first couple days, I might be really feeling that shit. But as I'm continuing not talking to you,
you get over it.
I start to get over it. Because it's niggas know I'm not done if I'm still responding. It's, you know, can I come talk to you? End up sucking dick. So you really done fucking with me? End up sucking dick. Move. You want me to stop? End up sucking dick. Like, I gotta cut you off.
Why do all of your situations end up with you sucking dick?
I'm just, like, the only way I can move around is to cut you off cold turkey. Like, nigga, when I'm done, I block you from social media. I block you from my phone. Nigga, I block your prayers. You gots to go.
You can't even pray for the man?
No, you can't pray for me. Like, you gotta go. Like, but if you do that shit to me, I'll be salty as fuck, though. I ain't gonna lie.
But that's a real nigga move, though. Because that's how niggas is. Like, a dude can be mad at his chick, don't want to talk to his chick, and if she's not there in his face, he's okay. But the minute that the girl cuts you off, it's an attitude. It's a problem. We want to fight. We kicking down doors. Like, what the no, bitch? Oh, you ain't going
especially
nowhere.
Especially when we cut you off and we post that selfie.
Man, that happy selfie. Or,
and he see, like, her titties, what the, man?
No. Somebody posted a video today. Tamia reposted it about the dude when chicks wear a certain kind of legging pants. Because he calls those the hoe pants. When your girl do that, when y'all fighting, and your girl break out the hoe pants, oh, nigga, get to the crib and fix that shit ASAP. Because somebody else is going to be in them drawers if she even got them on.
Because, I mean, I ain't going to lie. I was sick for a couple of days. This happened, what, Monday night? And this is Thursday. I was sick. But I was this close to being over it because it's, you know, it's stages.
Right.
And it was about to be Friday. I'm like, okay. And it's the weekend. But then, nigga text me about my birthday next week, talking about clear such and such day, and now, yeah.
That's what got you right there. Because with everything you going through, he said the right words.
Coochie went thump, 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 thump. And now look, what I'm going to do, end up sucking dick.
This has been another great episode of Hoecially Awkward.
You got to get your motherfucking life in order, fam. Every day should not result in you sucking
it's not even. She didn't even say getting dick down. She didn't say getting her pussy ate. She didn't say getting her back blown out. She said sucking dick.
Right.
Because that's how it always ends, man. Yeah, I just heartbreaking motherfucker though.
It hurts.
Like, man. What would you say was your hardest breakup?
Come back to me.
Said that like we really have a panel of fucking people here.
That means it's time for you to talk a little bit.
My first was my hardest though. Like, I wanted to fight that bitch like a nigga in the street. Like, real shit. Like, I wanted to square up. Because I felt like if I beat her up, she would feel the pain that I felt physically.
And you would be doing 5 to 10.
Yeah.
Well, as much as he felt it internally, he know that we ain't raised no whole ass niggas like that, so.
Honestly, now I had to think about it for a minute. I think my hardest did happen in the Air Force because it was this one light-skinned chick. I will not say no names because she actually do listen to the show, so she know this is about her. I actually stopped trying to be a man whore and actually want to settle down with her, only for me to find out that I was just a placeholder and to the dude that she was supposed to be with. Got his shit together. And that shit hurt deep, dude.
Like, you know what?
I still feel that pain a little bit every once in a while.
I'm going to try to have a reminder to kind of start off next show with that topic, like placeholders. Because
I'll add it to the notes.
Yeah, because that's definitely something. My hardest breakup was, you know, it was all this. Yeah.
Yeah, I believe you.
Yeah, like, because, dude, that was the only nigga, like, I loved. Not just, you know, L-word. And, you know, and he, like, no, like, through and through, like, we vibed on every level. We were the male and female version of each other. We had all the same interests. We had an amazing time to get, like, it sounds cliche, but it's like on some time stood still. Who's kicking it type shit. Because that's how much we vibe. So when shit broke bad the way it did, nigga, I was devastated. That shit took me years to get over that shit and recover from it.
Nigga, you gay.
Yeah.
No, but real talk, though. But that's a feeling that's hard to replicate, though. Like, when you find that person that vibes on every level. And even if you've taken it to the bedroom and the bedroom is even great there, like, you, that's the ones that make most folks go buy a ring ASAP and want to lock it down.
Every level.
Like, every level. It's hard to, like, a lot of people can get maybe 8 out of 10 what they want in a mate, and even then they're breaking their neck to marry that person. But if you get an 11 out of 10, because that means they got all 10 plus one more thing that you didn't even think about. And then if it ends, especially over dumb shit or a misunderstanding or just one bad decision, dog, that can, man.
Yeah, because it was, if I had to do a pro and con list,
really, dude,
it was, you got all of these pros on this side, but we were young.
Right.
And with him being young, you know, one of the major cons was niggas in the street. Fucking whatever, which got us in our situation, which was con number two. But those were the only two.
But that's the crazy
part. Those were the only two. Out of all of these good things that went on, those two were just, they were major
right
at that time. So, you know, that's what got us in that situation. But I spent 8 years basically trying to find that one person in everybody that I dated, and it's never been the same since then.
It never will be the same.
So...
But the fact that you were... The thing about, I guess, what a lot of people don't think about with breakups is, it's not only what you two go through, it's what the people that are close to you have to go through, too.
Okay, so y'all not finna sit here, because I know where this is going.
No.
No, I know where this is going. No. So we had to deal with you for all these years because of what he did, and you lashing out at us, and... Fuck you. Yeah, first you did. All, yeah, you did. Because y'all say it all the time, so I already knew where it was going.
I didn't say nothing.
But we on air right now, and I wasn't going to take it there. I was going to be like, sometimes the people around you have to be your help to get over the breakup. Mm-hmm. You just got defensive because
y'all say it all the time.
Good cleanup, bro. I feel you.
Right. Yeah. See, even mine know you feel the shit.
First of all, it wasn't a cleanup. That's exactly where I was going to go, though. I'm in business mode right now.
Anyways.
I mean, he had to deal with my shit when I broke up with Lexi.
You did a whole show right after it.
Damn. I wasn't. I had other shit going on.
No, you called then and told him to stop being a bitch ass nigga.
Did I?
Yes, you did.
I'm going to have to go back and replay it. Well, that is our time tonight, but I cannot close out the show without wishing the legendary Gemini Prince a happy birthday. We're recording a bit early, so I could squeeze in an extra show while I'm on vacation and, you know, getting them little rub downs on the beach. I think I'm starting to finally get excited for it.
As you should. We getting excited for you.
I've been kind of down, you know, with everything going on. So I think I'm finally starting to get in the swing. Okay, you know, a couple weeks, you out of here. So I don't know. But just had to show some respect because that is one of the greatest Geminis
man
ever.
Purple Rain, will always be the greatest movie ever. The fact that they threw a whole bitch in the garbage can.
You know what? Thanks again to all my listeners. Feel free to leave feedback, discuss the show, leave topic ideas and questions on the official Hoecially Awkward Facebook page and follow on Instagram as well. Till next time, we gotta go. We gotta go.